This is, I think, seen more often in the NGO sector or people in the development sector. We don't see so much of it in the private or for-profit organizations. And you also partner with governments and various different organizations. Sometimes they're exclusive to a certain region or certain specialty. What are those few learnings that you have working with different partners, Mr. Mohanty?
Site service India does is, you know, we have been traditionally working on eye health. So we need to have a lot of hospital partners and a lot of, you know, grassroots level partners to implement our strategy. And we have found over the years that's an extremely important way to actually take forward the strategy of eye health. And, you know, globally also we have been working with a lot of partners. In India, we work close to 60, 65 partners, both hospital and NGO partners, and kind of do a tripartite work between us to ensure that we take care of the avoidable blindness.
Partnerships are like marriage. There are pleasures and challenges both. Our partners, primarily we partner with governments because we believe that India is all about scale, and the smallest of the state that you take in India is probably will be larger than many countries in the world. So we work with the governments because in primary healthcare, primarily it's not very profitable, so the private sector hasn't entered much, the needs are there much. The government finds it a challenge in terms of reaching out the last mile. So we find it makes sense to partner with the government because where they lack, it's not like George Bernard Shaw's story where a beautiful actress is supposed to have told, my beauty and your brains together will get a beautiful children. And Bernard Shaw is supposed to have said, what if they get my looks and your brains kind of stuff. So fortunately, it's not that with the government. So we bring in strengths from the corporate sector. I work for Piramals. Earlier, I used to work with a large IT company. So we bring those competencies to the table. Of execution, of focus, and systems and processes. And the government brings in the funds and their mandate to serve a large number of people. So we believe that our primary partners, therefore, are governments. So we do see there's a lot of power in working with partnerships. And we believe in creating a platform so that multiple partners and multiple services can ride on that. Similarly, our van services that are there, the last mile health reach, where we reach almost 5,000 villages in one of the states every month on a given date. We believe services like what Mr. Mohanty was talking about can be delivered on that with an optometrician being added. So we think that partnering with the government, creating a platform and inviting other partners to deliver their services much cheaper rather than building platforms, which is more difficult for any NGO which wants to scale. So therefore, for us, that is the context where we look at partnerships and alliances. So we keep our platforms open enough for people to plug in their services, whether it's a telemedicine service, whether it is a voice-based service, or whether it is a van-based service. That's how we look at the partnerships.
We look for support partners, implementation partners, and then the policy partners. Since we want to create healthcare solutions for the poor, the things that are not been solved for the poor for the time being, so we need implementation partners on ground to find an executable, replicable, scalable plan. For that, we need resources, manpower, and funding, so we look for resource partners. Once this product is ready, then we want to give it to somebody who can really make a massive change with that given solution, which is just the government. And healthcare can't be done without the government because the scale is too big and the space is too large. And the regulations are essential to delivery of healthcare. So government has to be a partner. So three partners, support partners, execution or implementation partners, and policy partners.
But for us, like the main strength is the community. You know, when you want to bring up something for a sustainable development, we always depend on the financial assistance either by the government or corporate or other NGOs, which is. But they are, of course, as he has rightly mentioned, they are like supplementing partners, complementing partners. But the community mobilization is one of the key issues in partnership where you can take up to the program to a sustainable level. So for us, strength is the community.
And of course, we have lots of knowledge partner in designing the solution. So we have a three-pronged kind of approach. One is medical, nutritional, and third is the sanitation component. So we borrow lots of idea from other people in designing the solution. And the most important, though people think that my job is to give money, but in this project, my job to ask money. And I'm very thankful for the lots of local industry. Within a 3 month, I mobilized around more than 60 lakh rupees for this this project. And all local, someone is donated 50,000, 30,000, 40,000. And I, from very first day, I say that really I'm experimenting. I don't know this little bit, but people were kind enough to participate in the whole process. So that funding partner is very, very encouraging side.
You know, one of the things that we believed in SiteSaver is like Mr. Sibban said about working with government primarily to make things sustainable. So we have been through our own funds, been trying many projects, many pilots, and you know, trying to make it replicable, make it scalable with the support of partners and primarily the government partner. So all over the globe, I think in all the 34 countries that we work, the approach is primarily to develop capacities, to develop demonstrable models, and then scale it up, both on iHealth and on education.
Our approach is very simple. And since I have an advantage because I'm a physician and I worked in healthcare for all my life, and there's nothing else I know except healthcare, there's a space in healthcare the world over, which is a no man's land, nobody enters there. If you occupy that space, you'll succeed. And that's the space between the patient and the doctor. The way the health structure is designed in the world over, especially in India and so more rural India, is the supply side. That you supply healthcare, you supply doctors, you supply hospitals, you supply primary health centers, you supply drugs. The question is who's working in demand? Now the demand needs two things. One is affordability and access. Affordability is either out of pocket or some kind of insurance mechanism. We need two tools. Second tool is access. Access is much more complex. Access depends on the context, the space, the geographical location, the distance, the culture, and above all, the cognitive skills of the person who's accessing healthcare. Does he intelligently understand what health really is all about? In other words, can he prevent disease before the symptoms appear? So this space is available for anybody to work in because it's not been occupied. And that's a space we occupied in having an intuitive understanding. Give an example. We worked in a recent example, he said, tuberculosis. Now we know tuberculosis kills more people in India than most of the other diseases. The government data is 1,000 people die of tuberculosis every day. Our data shows it's many more than that. So tuberculosis, the problem, WHO recommends that you detect TB and then you treat them. DOTS program, highly successful the world over, that you recognize TB and you cure them. The key is, again, that space, the detection part, before detection, how do you do this? In the area that we worked in, there were 19 registered cases of tuberculosis. So we took the healthcare to the doorstep of the people in a campaign mode, and we detected 10 times more patients, 192 more. And all 192 were then brought back to the public health system where they were, all 192 were treated, 185 recovered, and one died, four died, and two disappeared from the area, went somewhere else. So the idea is that if you take healthcare to the doorstep as opposed to waiting for the patient to come to the primary health, that space is for anybody to take, whether it's in maternal care, nutrition, sanitation. Now, to give two or three examples where the world has succeeded, for example, the smallpox eradication. You occupied that space. Polio, guinea worm, wherever you are taking a proactive effort to go to the patient and give the healthcare, and so is HMRI. Started in Andhra, extraordinary work. They've taken the healthcare, crossed the space, gone to the patient, and not wait for the patients to come to you.
I have a very specific question to Mrs. Sujata. Whenever there is a great amount of hypocrisy in India. Whenever there is talk of sex or sex education, there seems to be a lot of anti-activities that go on. But since you deal with SRH, which is sexual health, and then very recently you have started off activity called Sparsh along with Island FS. What has been your experiences? What's been the kind of reach, and what are the plans going ahead? Your plans with Sparsh?
Sparsh is one innovative website we have, like, because if you see the more of the, like, often if you want to take up the sexuality education for a youth, you know, it's not so easy task to go to the school level and impart this education. Though it's not a sex education, it's a sexuality education, which wholly depends on the behavioral attitudes and all. And you know, like, if we see, like, the whole life, the population, the youths, is like maximum number of youths access the internet nowadays. So, and moreover, like, they are more towards the other part of the sexual life than healthy sexuality life. So in order to inculcate this sexuality education, we started this Sparsh program, where, like, many number of youths are coming to this website asking their questions, and we are giving a sort of informed choice. It's like giving an education, and the choice is left to the youth in order to tell that, okay, what is healthy and what it leads up. And now it's like we also thought of scaling it up to many other languages. Now it's in Hindi and in English we are coming up with. And but, like, if the internet users, if you see, they can very well manage, because once they are into internet, they can very well manage with the English and the Hindi languages, and which is where we are scaling. And now more youths are towards this Sparsh program. And apart from Sparsh also, like, it is for urbanites, it's for educated, it is for literate youths. And if you come across the rural youths also, we want to take up this comprehensive sexuality education. So we have a series of 7 sessions wherein we are just explaining, because there are a lot of, like, in school curriculum also, there is a chapter on sexuality education, but still it's not like it's just shut down, because they never come up with this, because teachers don't know how to deal with this chapter also. So sometimes they take the help of this association, like how exactly we are going to educate the youths on comprehensive sexuality education. So 7 series of talks where we are taking up to the rural youths also. This is how we are expanding to the rural slums and urbans.
You are in that field, and then how do you foresee yourself, as in, will it be an organization that will continue to be at the mercy of the government and the people at the helm, or do you foresee yourself getting into a kind of a revenue model where, you know, like, it becomes a sustainable entity?
I think so. The government is something like a Maibab in a way. I think it has got a responsibility of delivering few services to the people on certain things which I think makes sense. As long as the society is sustainable and we're paying taxes and government is sustainable, I think these services ought to be sustainable. Otherwise, why do we need a government is a question. There are some primary services which I think a society ought to deliver to its citizens. One is primary education and infrastructure like sanitation, quality of drinking water, and primary health care. And if those things cannot be sustained by society, I think the society's sustenance itself is in question, is what I think. Because today, I think United States, if you see the business model that they have gone for, the escalating costs of healthcare and the percentage of their total GDP that they have to spend on healthcare, it itself becomes unsustainable after a while. So therefore, the key question is that what kind of models does one look at in terms of delivering healthcare is both an ethical question as well as a larger question for the society. If you ask for our strategy of an organization to survive, I think we would survive for 2-3 reasons on these kinds of services. Because there is an execution gap of delivery. And today, fortunately, governments, especially politicians, understand no longer they can fool people all the time by giving a false promise and walk away. And consistently, public has been giving their mandate to those governments which are delivering on governance, even if it's only 10% of what is expected of them. We can see that, examples all around the country. So the politicians today understand the importance of governance, importance of delivering services, and therefore getting something. So they do understand a powerful scheme like a 104 or a 108 where they can go talk about. There was a chief minister, at least 2 chief ministers I can talk about. His political speeches used to make the sound of an ambulance. He said, "Kuing, kuing, 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 do you get a vehicle to your village?" The people say, yes, it comes there. Then I said, look, this is what we brought to you. Similarly, when we were delivering medical services, especially antenatal checkups and identifying and screening for non-communicable diseases like hypertension and diabetes, I'm happy to share with you just in Andhra in 1.5 years, we identified and screened close to 1.2 million pregnant women, about 1 million hypertensives and diabetics, which wouldn't have happened otherwise. Now, and the government sees, as politicians see, the value of delivering free medicine through that. And it didn't cost them much. It cost them to reach 25,000 villages every month per annum. It cost less than 70 crores or 100 crores. Now, it's much cheaper way for that, that they can get publicity. And therefore, to that extent, I think as long as still there are gaps in terms of delivery of services, probably there's an opportunity for us to survive. Do we see a revenue model as we're going forward? Do we need to create? I do see that there are different segments in the market that we serve. When I go to a village, a lot of people ask me this question. How do you differentiate between the poor and the non-poor? Do you take white card, yellow card? Different societies, different states have different cards. I say in a village, anybody who's willing to stand in a line is poor enough for me. If he's from a middle-class farmer, he would never allow his son or daughter or daughter-in-law to go and stand in a line because there's a sense of dignity or whatever. He would rather go buy it, whether he can afford it or not. So anybody who is willing to stand in a line is okay with me. But I also see there are some people who come, get screened, but they don't come back to take the medicines. Where are these guys going? These guys are going to private sector. They go to the nearest person. After they discover that they're diabetics or hypertensives or on the borderline, when they get confirmed, they don't come to us for services. So I do see there's a potential for us to leverage that differential service. Possibly we could do that as we go further. So robbing Peter to pay Paul kind of a model, if it ever comes to be.
I have a specific question to Mr. Naveen. Training, comes as one of the top priorities with you and your organization. What is it that you're trying to, train these people on? Why is there so much emphasis on it? Is there a deficit of trained manpower, or is it that you're trying to inculcate certain skills in the people, or is there something wrong with the current set of educational system that you're trying to correct in your own way?
Do you think any work we do, and then there's all big policy change, etc., but who will execute? Who will execute at the village level? Who will execute at a taluka level? Who will execute at a district level? After having lots of health plan, whatever thick report, WHO or Government of India or state government can produce. We need a people. That's a straight and first and last thing. So we not only in the health sector, in education, in agriculture, livelihood, the same scenario. So why we were able to take on this project so very quickly? Because we have a good trained people with us, which can every day go to the field. Like in the four-pronged strategy in delivery, like first we collect the data, test the prototype, execute it, deliver it, measure the data and close. This is like a pretty simple, everyone kind of knows. So all you can put all the brain, WHO has the finest training material, you can get it. And there is, I don't think anything they have left it. But at the end, the people who are at the delivery end, they really don't know those kind of stuff. So training, we thought there's a key component in all aspect. Probably Shivan and all will be agree with me that the people who is motivated, excited, and go villages or urban, rural, whatever population, that's the key heart of all the things. Not how many reports, how many training manuals or whatever we produce. So if you have hundreds of people, those who are excited, I think that's the hope for me. So I thought, instead of going this side, that side, let me focus on the people part. And that's how within a 4 months, we were able to reach that large number of population directly.
Now I have a very generic kind of a question to all of you, which is about volunteers. All of you work with volunteers, you train volunteers, and how much of your work or your efforts depend on volunteers? What is it that you seek out of these volunteers, and how do you keep them motivated?
Sustaining any program is like the one very key component is volunteerism. You know, whenever we start up any project or anything, unless there is a financial assistance, the project or anything goes on very well. And once it is withdrawn, then the system, whole system collapse, you know. So the volunteers, like in the initial stage itself, we need to create a sort of a volunteers who can be, whom we can give a sort of a recognition also, because there are so many people who come up with working, and we have to motivate. Like example, we have started a sort of a community-based social marketing concept, which is like we have trained all the grassroots functionaries in the community, who may be the panchayat members, who may be the ashas, who may be the active youths, who may be other common women, like who is very active, like SAG member. So we identify such active members, and from the beginning we involve them with this volunteer model. And you know, like once they go on performing, we have to give sort of a recognition. Like example, if you see, there are so many people who are working for HIV, who are poor, who are socially excluded, who are stigmatized. And if you want to bring them on the mainstream, that volunteerism, when we inculcate, then certainly they'll come up and work to the community. So this is what motivation we are giving them. And now, like if you see, maximum number of clients are fed to our clinic by these volunteers, not any other paid people or stakeholders. See, whenever they come to our clinic, they bring any clients, like 5 to 6 clients, they'll come for the preventive care, not even sick care. Like they come up with the preventive care and they register their names and they'll tell, okay, I brought these 10 cases now, this day. And like we have thought of even starting sharing a sort of an incentive, like how the cuts are given for the doctors and all, because in order to motivate them, it's not a major, like there, it is the profit sharing is not so high, though it is a volunteer. And so very little figures we are speaking with, but which is feeding maximum number of clients, or bringing the sick people to our organization. Yeah,
I'm a great admirer of volunteerism in healthcare. And I give practical example. I'm also on the business side of things. I run a business also. In business context, I will have not a single volunteer working in my office. It doesn't work. But healthcare delivery at the beyond the last mile and the last mile should be volunteer-based, because I am a volunteer for my own health. I should be responsible to retain my own health. I should be responsible for my family, my street, my community, my village. That much responsibility I must own either partially or completely. And if we that translate into execution, and how many volunteers would you have? You can train hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of volunteers. Even if you take 25% attrition rate, which is in my organization, you train 25% more. Ultimately, every villager becomes a volunteer for his own health. What does it really do? Let me give you an example. In 2008, when we started maternal mortality reduction in a district in UP, the published data, maternal mortality was 500. Into the field we went, we found it was 645 per 100,000, 1 lakh live births. We started working through volunteers. We have so far trained close to 3,000 volunteers, out of which about 75% active, and we have only 12 supervisors. We cover 1,000 villages. We have 1 to 2 volunteers per village, and there's no end point. It's not that we're going to stop at some point training volunteers. It goes volunteers after volunteers after volunteers. We train every month, and they come. We train them in droves, let them loose, and they come back, and we retrain them. So it goes on and on. The cycle goes on. So the maternal mortality dropped from 645 from 2008 to July 2011 by 92%. The last data I have is last 7 months. We have had 1,235 deliveries. 1,253 deliveries. In 1,253 deliveries in our area, that data we have, there's been not a single mother's death, which is our declared pledge by the volunteers. Take a pledge that no mother should die in this area. How far we'll succeed, I don't know when the whole data comes, because the denominator is 100,000, we only 1,253. But even if you take the district data that I have, which I collected recently, out of 39,000 deaths in the whole district, 39,000 pregnancies in the whole district, so far in the past 7 months, there have been only 6 deaths. In other words, we're far ahead of the MDG goal, which is 105 by 2015, all done by volunteers with only 12 supervisors. We have replicated the model in Gadak. Prashant is our project manager here. He'll testify they've even got that through voluntary force of very minimal supervision. You volunteered, you trained the volunteers, let them loose. We have trained maybe 400 or 500 volunteers by now. We work in about 300 villages across 3 districts, and the results are similar. UP, though it's only 18 months, but the trend we can already see, we are already far ahead in neonatal mortality reduction. We are better than the state average in maternal mortality, and we are immunization rates are at least double the local standard, all through volunteers.